morning, all. Thank you guys for being here, especially on short notice. It was a quick turnaround for everyone. Jeff, we'll start with an opening statement, and then we'd be happy to field questions. Thank you.
Morning, everybody. As Nick said, I'll just share a few comments, and then obviously happy to answer any questions that that you all have. You know, obviously, not easy to make a coaching decision and a coaching change like this. As we shared yesterday, the decision was based on the findings of a UVM Affirmative Action and Equal Opportunity report that that determined that Coach Woodcroft had sent inappropriate text messages to a student that that failed to maintain appropriate professional boundaries. It's obviously something that we take very seriously. The investigation was prompted by a complaint that came into the athletic department to an athletic department staff member in the middle of March. That complaint was immediately turned over to AAEO, which is the university office that's responsible for investigating these types of matters and that operates completely independent of the athletic department. That office, I saw the final AAEO report on Monday of this week. Obviously took some time to review it, discussed it with other senior leaders in the athletic department and on campus, identified the finding that I referred to earlier, that there were inappropriate text messages that were sent by Coach Woodcroft and that were in violation of the university policy around professional boundaries in relationships with students, and then made the determination that it was no longer appropriate for him to be coaching the men's ice hockey team. We shared this yesterday as well, that the athletic department has very high standards and expectations of our coaches and of our staff. That's particularly true for head coaches who have a special responsibility, just given the visibility of their roles and their roles as mentors and role models for our student athletes. And when conduct falls below our expectation, it's incumbent upon us to take the appropriate action, and that's what we did in this case. I want to say a few things about Coach Wheedler. As you know, we named Steve Wheedler as our interim coach yesterday for the 23-24 season. I think we're really fortunate to have somebody of Steve's experience level and capability to take over the program. I've watched him closely for the 3 years that he's been here. He has impeccable integrity. He's incredibly professional. He has great respect in the locker room from our student athletes. He's well respected in the college hockey community, and he's been a big part of recruiting three really outstanding classes into the men's ice hockey program. Obviously, we want to maintain the momentum that we have and maintain continuity. It's really important in a situation like this. So we're fortunate to have Steve take on this role. Scott Mosier, who's one of our other assistants, is going to be continuing with the program. He's been exceptional as well. So I'm comfortable with where the hockey program is at, but obviously a disruption that we didn't anticipate. But we're going to move on and support our student athletes and the program in the best way possible.
You mentioned in the press release these inappropriate text messages.
Yeah.
What exactly were in those text messages, or what were the nature that caused them to cross the boundary?
Yeah, you know, as you can imagine, student privacy is really paramount in this. So I hope you'll understand why I'm going to be cautious about sharing any of the specifics that would allow a student to be identified who was involved in this process. So I'm not going to get into, you know, giving real specific details about the messages. You know, the way we've characterized it publicly, I hope paints a picture that they were inappropriate, that they didn't maintain the level of professional boundaries that are expected from employees and their interactions with students. And obviously it was significantly, sufficiently serious to warrant termination.
Do you have specific dates for when the complaint was filed, when the investigation started, ended, and when he was terminated?
Yeah, the initial complaint was referred to AAEO on March 16th. There was some preliminary work done in that office to determine whether or not there should be a formal investigation. It was obviously determined that that was warranted. So the formal investigation began soon after that. And as I shared, I got the final report this past Monday, which I think was July 17th. I'm sorry, was there more that you had asked tonight?
No, okay. And then was he terminated also?
Yeah, no, he was terminated yesterday.
Was Coach Woodcroft placed on administrative leave at any point, or was this just entirely pending the results of the investigation?
He was never placed on administrative leave. We did take an interim step soon after the complaint was filed, and Todd, in addition to being instructed not to have any contact with any of the students who were involved, Todd was instructed to work from home until the matter was resolved, but he was not put on leave.
If these messages were inappropriate, why was he allowed to keep coaching during the time that he was investigated?
Because the university has a process to determine whether, in fact, the conduct constituted a violation of university policy, and part of taking these issues seriously is making sure that everybody involved is treated fairly, both the complainant and the respondent, and that in the case of Todd, that he's afforded full due process as part of the university's investigation. You can look at something at face value without context, and it's just something we all want to be cautious about to make sure that we're being thorough. This is obviously, these are serious matters that impact on people's lives, and it's, I think all of us at UVM, and have a ton of respect for our Office of Affirmative Action and Equal Opportunity that does this. They're the professionals. As I mentioned, they operate independent of athletics. We're not best positioned to be investigating these types of situations. So their process is very thorough, and appropriately so it was in this case. And it's one of the reasons that I have the confidence I do, once I do receive a final report that lays out what the findings are. I'm confident that's accurate, and feel comfortable acting on those findings.
Is the student still enrolled, and would there be any discipline for the student in the future?
No discipline at all for any of the students involved. And again, I'm not going to comment on anything related to the student that could identify that person in any way.
Yeah. You said students, were there multiple incidents?
No. But it's not uncommon in a situation like this for there to be one student involved, but also witnesses and other students that are connected to the process in some way.
Did the student file the complaint, or was it referred up the line somewhere along the way?
The complaint came in to a staff member in the athletic department, and it was referred referred immediately to AAEO.
You said that the March 16th complaint, the formal investigation starts soon after. The specific date of when the investigation started?
I don't recall exactly.
In March?
Yeah, it was in March that the parties were notified that there would be a formal investigation.
What factors were investigated in the process?
The complaint was related to inappropriate text communication, and that's what the investigation focused on.
Was the contact
context of the texts sufficient to make a determination? Or is there any other evidence that you guys considered?
Again, the investigation happens exclusively within AAEO. Then I get a final report that lays out their process, all of the various findings. So that's what I was considering.
Do you have any comment to Todd's attorney's statement that they said the decision was contrary to the facts and the law?
No. I read his attorney's comments. Again, I feel very confident in the university's process, that it was thorough, that it was fair, that Todd was afforded due process throughout. And again, when the final report came to me, I was comfortable that the findings were substantiated, and I was able to act on that information with a high level of confidence.
Was the investigation a breach of Woodcroft's contract, and do you guys owe him any more money?
He was terminated effective immediately without any additional compensation.
And do you know if you'll be, like, kind of going off of the attorney's statement, do you know if you'll be battling this out in the courts at all? It seems as though he's going to pursue some sort of, they mentioned justice in their press release. Do you know anything about that yet?
I don't know any, what actions Todd may take or any of his representatives, no.
When was the rest of the coaching staff and when were the players informed that the investigation was going on? When were they informed that it was concluded with this result?
I met with the team yesterday to notify them of my decision and our plans to name Coach Wheeler as our interim head coach. Todd hadn't been around, but we had not formally notified the team of the specifics, just again out of respect to him and other students.
Focused on text messages, was there any other communication between the two parties, or was it just via text?
The only thing that was the complaint was only about inappropriate text messages, and I guess I do want to just be really clear that there was no allegations or indication of anything beyond inappropriate text messages. Nothing else ever came up as a concern.
You guys have been very proactive with this. Is there anything that stems from mishandling of cases in the past, such as potentially Anthony Lamb, that have made you guys be so proactive on this case?
No, I don't think so. I think every situation is unique, and we take it all incredibly seriously. There's certainly different dynamics when you have students involved versus a staff member. There's different legal requirements, but whatever the situation is that's involving anybody related to our department, we take it seriously. We refer it directly to the offices on campus that are responsible for adjudicating and that have the experience and the expertise to do so. And when there is a finding, and if somebody is found to be responsible for misconduct, then we act. No, I would not say there's a connection between the two and our response in any way.
Does UVM Athletics have any plans for prevention of further incidents or future incidents?
We're always working on educating ourselves and making sure our coaches and our staff and our student athletes are aware of what our expectations are, what the university's expectations are. We're obviously a very visible part of the campus, and so we take that responsibility very seriously, and work hard with partners on campus to educate our student athletes and our coaches and staff on all sorts of a range of issues that might come up, and then we also think a lot about how we respond when something does come up. We have 430 student athletes, we have 85 staff members in the department, and none of us are perfect, and there are going to be things that come up in our department, in other departments on campus and other athletic departments around the country. You just need to open the newspaper and you can see it. And so we work really hard on the prevention side, and we understand that things are going to come up. And when they do, we take it seriously, and we operate with integrity and with our values front and center, and don't shy away from having to make hard decisions when they're warranted.
Has this prompted any other investigations?
No. No.
To your knowledge, was there a pre-existing relationship knowledge of each other between the students and Coach Woodcroft before it ventured into inappropriate text messages, or did it start with that?
Again, I'm not going to get into the, you know, any of the details of the investigation. The focus, the only inappropriate conduct was related to these text messages that we've discussed.
Do you feel that the athletic department and university is doing enough to, I guess, help prevent these sorts of things, but also like the due process of the investigation, how it actually played out?
Again, on the prevention side, we're always looking at how we're educating our coaches and our staff and our student athletes around the myriad issues that can arise and that they face. So, you know, and we'll continue to do that and try to improve. In terms of campus process, again, I have a high level of confidence and trust in our AAEO office. They're trained, they're experienced, they do these investigations on a regular basis, and they're thorough, and they are respectful of all of the parties involved, and ensure due process for everybody and the fair treatment of everybody. And so when I get a final report, I can feel comfortable knowing that the process has been thorough, it's been handled by people who are experts at this, and I can feel comfortable making whatever decision I have to make.
What's the background check process when you're doing an interview process to hire a coach?
Well, two sides of that. One is there is sort of a technical background check that, you know, where we use outside third parties that are able to draw on information that we wouldn't have at our fingertips. And then there's a less formal background check, which is a lot of calls to people that are on somebody's reference list, that are not on somebody's reference list. And I'm not talking specifically for Todd, but for all of our coaches and staff that are hired here, something that we prioritize to make sure that we're hiring the right people and we're bringing people in who have done good work and exhibited integrity and sound decision making prior to joining our department.
Just to clarify, so this investigation didn't go through the athletic department at all. You guys received the notice and then passed it on, like, after report?
Yeah, the initial complaint came into the athletic department, and it was immediately referred to the AAEO office on campus, which is the office that's responsible for investigating and adjudicating complaints against of this nature. But yes, it was not an investigation that occurred within the athletic department. Once the investigation is complete, that's what I said, on Monday I got the final report, which detailed the findings and all of the background related to the case. And that's typical, whether it's athletics or another unit on campus, would get the final report, and the lead in that department would make a decision about discipline and any possible sanctions.
And then I know you mentioned the date of when you guys became aware of the investigation, but can you tell us when these text messages are actually from?
Again, I'm not going to go into any details about the text messages, other than to say they were inappropriate, and they failed to respect professional boundaries that we expect of our coaches and staff.
How do you reassure students, parents, student athletes, et cetera, that they're in a good spot here, that they're in a good position here, that something like this isn't going to happen to them?
Yeah. you know, I think everybody on this campus prioritizes student well-being and student safety. And so that plays out in a lot of different ways, including how we respond to situations where maybe a staff member or another student didn't meet our standards or expectations. And so, you know, my hope is people see this and see that we responded appropriately and that we took appropriate steps and actions to ensure the safety of the campus community, which is all of our top priority.
How do you reassure the players on this year's hockey team that this is still the right place?
Yeah, as I said, I've had some conversations with the team. I met with them yesterday. I've met with the team leaders to talk really openly about all of this, and I have a ton of respect for how they've handled themselves. They, you know, they know what they can control and what they can't control. You know, one of the things we say to our recruits all the time is choose UVM because you want to be on this campus, not because of a particular coach, not because of a teammate or a schedule or a league. Like, make sure this is the right place for you, and because things happen. You know, student athletes get hurt, coaches change, and you want to make sure it's the right place. And obviously, I'm aware of the changing landscape in college athletics and how student athletes are moving on from one school to another on a regular basis. But I think our players have a ton of respect for Coach Wiedler and Coach Mosier, and I think that continuity piece is really important. So I think our players are going to put their heads down and work hard in the classroom, in the weight room, on the ice, to maximize the potential that we have as a program this year and going forward. As I said, I feel like we've taken significant strides over the past 3 years, and we've had increasing numbers of wins each of those years. I think the character of our players is continuing to be at a very high level. And so I'm optimistic about the program and about our student athletes. And we've got a great lineup of recruits coming in. As you know, in college hockey, recruits are sort of stacked up. And I know Coach Wiedler's been on the phone hours just reassuring recruits and families and advisors about the direction of the program. I think some of you know that, you know, my background is as a hockey player at UVM. My colleague Joe Gervais, our associate athletic director, all played hockey at UVM. So this is a program that we know well. It's a landscape that we know well, and you know, we're not going to step on anybody's toes in terms of creating game plans, but we're going to do everything we can to support the program and make sure they're well positioned for success.
In terms of the interim tag, is it kind of a year-by-year basis, or I guess when will you decide whether you should stay or you want to find a new coach?
Yeah, it's not something that we're in a rush to decide right now. We've said that he's going to be our coach for the 23-24 season. You know, there's examples in our department. Look at women's basketball, where Coach Kresge was an interim coach for a year after a coaching change. She did an amazing job. We hired her in the position permanently, and you know, all she's done is go on to win an America's championship this past year and two straight 20-win seasons. So I'd love to see that play out in the same way with Coach Wiedler, and I think he's capable of it. But ultimately, that's an evaluation that I'll have to make as the year goes along, and ultimately at the end of the season to see what, you know, what the leadership situation is, and if he's the right person to continue, or if the program would be better served with somebody else.
So, in your interpretation, is this basically kind of Steve's got the year and we'll come back in March and kind of figure it out?
Yeah. That's maybe a little bit of an oversimplification, but yeah, see, we're not, this is not a 1 or 2 month thing. We're going to conduct a search and have somebody new in place for the season. He's our coach for the upcoming year, and then we'll evaluate from there.
As a result of the change in coaching situation and investigation overall, are you aware of any student athletes or coaches that have decided to leave the program at all?
No.
When was Coach Wheaton happening or had reached its conclusion and that you were going to tap him as the interim coach?
He was aware of the investigation because of of Todd working off campus, you know, from pretty much the start of the investigation. But didn't finalize him as our interim head coach until the decision was made about Todd yesterday.
You mentioned obviously that you and Joe are both somebody who've been around the program for a long time.
Yeah.
Is there any points where you guys look at somebody who hasn't been around the program as much and kind of, I don't know, ask them to take a macro view of the situation, just because you've been so close with the program and obviously there's some emotional draw and whatever, and you try and make the best decision you can, but do you ever kind of ask somebody else for help in a situation?
You mean just evaluating the program generally speaking?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's part of, as an administrator, you're always trying to pull in opinions and feedback from outside. You know, I'm very aware that, you know, that the vast majority, almost all of my professional experience has been at UVM. You know, and as it relates to the hockey program, even dating back to my time as an undergrad. And so, you know, like a lot of ADs, I'm involved in some national work, specifically with hockey. I'm currently the chair of the Division I Men's Ice Hockey Committee. And so, you know, I'm exposed to colleagues all over the country, other coaches, other administrators, hockey people. And I talk all the time and pick their brain about the landscape of college hockey and specifically about our program and how we can elevate our program to a championship level, which is ultimately our goal. I mean, you all follow our teams closely. You know, it's been an incredible couple years of success for UVM Athletics, and we want men's ice hockey to participate at that level as well as a championship program. And we've got an incredible history here. We've got an incredibly passionate fan base. And we're, you know, part of my responsibility along with the coaches and my colleagues in the department is to make sure we're putting the pieces in place for that program to have championship level success, including getting outside perspectives on what we're doing.
Real quick, just going back to when you first got the complaint, was this during the season? Because I know the season went a little bit into March, or was this after the season?
Yeah, the complaint came in after the season.
And you mentioned there was some preliminary determination whether an investigation would be done after the complaint was filed. What factors go into that decision to whether to file a bigger investigation? And were there any lesser complaints that didn't receive an investigation?
So again, that happens in Affirmative Action Equal Opportunity Office. So when they receive a complaint, they evaluate that. They may talk to some of the individuals involved to make a determination on whether or not they should move forward with a formal investigation. I don't know all the factors that they consider, but I think they're trying to determine whether or not there's significant evidence that warrants a formal investigation. That's obviously what occurred in this place. I'm not aware of any concerns that were expressed that didn't advance to a formal investigation. I want to be really careful about providing too much of that detail, just out of protection for the privacy of the students involved. But the complaint came in and it was immediately referred to AAEO.
What's your mention, kind of your message to the players and students? What's your message to the fans? You know, this program has a lot of legacy and was starting to build towards a place, like you said, where winning more games, but with this change up, how do you kind of reassure them that you know, there's still a future of winning here at UVM?
Well, I think, you know, the message is that that all of us in the department and at the university are committed to a championship level program in men's ice hockey. And it's not something that, and we've been there, we've been to two Frozen Fours, so we know it can happen here. And we're constantly looking to see what are the pieces that we need to put in place to have that level of success. Obviously, this is it's not something that we anticipated or wanted to happen, but I also don't think it has to result in a big step backwards for the program. Again, our current players are fully bought in, fully committed. That was came through loud and clear in my conversation with them yesterday and in other conversations that I've had. We've got a great group of recruits lined up that are excited to come and be a part of this program. So I think we've made progress, and I think we'll continue to make progress. And I and we're all gonna look forward, and obviously incredibly appreciative of the support that we get in the community.
You said you had a meeting with the team yesterday. What was the reception to Coach Winkler being bumped up to the interim head coach?
Very positive. He has a ton of respect. He, you know, Coach Wheeler was the person who, to a large extent, recruited most of our current players. He's been very involved in their development, obviously involved in every aspect of our program. So he's a very, very much a known quantity to our current student athletes. And, you know, I think not surprisingly, our student athletes, you know, that continuity and familiarity is important to them. You know, it is unsettling to lose your head coach, but when you have another assistant who you know and you like and you respect and you believe in that takes over, it eases that anxiety.
Yeah,